Today is June 16th, 2024. The conflict in Ukraine continues to move towards greater escalation between the collective West and Russia, with Ukraine trapped in the middle as a proxy of Western powers. I'm going to talk about the different ways that this could potentially escalate, what the collective West is attempting to do to change the tide in the fighting, which in and of itself indicates that Ukraine is doing very poorly in this proxy war. But before we do that, let's take a look at the map. This is liveuamap.com. It is a pro-Ukrainian map, so please keep that in mind when looking at it. This is a map that even when Ukrainian sources admit territory has been lost, it will delay changing its map for days, sometimes even week. So please keep that in mind. The reason I use a pro-Ukrainian map is to show that even a pro-Ukrainian map stubbornly trying to skew information in Ukraine's favor, even it is showing a very bleak picture for Ukraine. So let's take a look at it. Everything in red is held by Russian forces. And as you can see, all of these red icons indicate Russian military activity. Blue icons indicate Ukrainian activity. And this is the situation every single day when you check this map. And as you can see, the red rifle icons indicate Russian forces are operating in these areas, including in areas beyond what they have clearly and completely consolidated control over. So this is the salient in Zaporozhye that Ukraine created during its 2023 failed offensive. Russian forces have been clawing this very meager territorial gain by Ukraine back little by little. And we can see fighting all the way from southern Donetsk along the line of contact, particularly outside of Donetsk city and Avdiivka. Russian forces continuing to move westward. We can see fighting along the line of contact around Seversk. And of course, Chasiv Yar, just west of Bakhmut. Russian forces continue applying pressure there. And of course, we go all the way up to the north, where Russian forces have taken territory in Kharkov, compelling Ukrainian forces to deploy what little reserves they have left to try to stabilize the front, as they say. And as we can see, the fighting continues here, especially in Volchansk. This is a pro-Ukrainian map. They are indicating that Ukraine is somehow taking this territory back. Everywhere else, including pro-Ukrainian sources, indicate that Russia is consolidating control over the northern part of Volchansk, north of that river running through the built-up area of Volchansk. Let's look at these icons here. We have drone attacks. They're talking about drone attacks. This one in particular, they're not really talking about any damage. This one is talking about an airfield where they claim Su-34 fighter bombers are used to carry out glide bomb attacks. And you have to remember, there are multiple airfields where such operations are conducted out of. These fighter bombers have long ranges. They could move these around if necessary, if attacks like this became frequent and successful. How successful are these attacks? Well, if we click on this, they claim that they have footage before and after of two destroyed Su-34 fighter bombers. This is what they're claiming. Two fighter bombers. And they claim this follows another attack that took place sometime last month. So here's the Sky News article on this. Ukrainian forces strike military airfield in Russia amid sustained campaign on Putin's Russian Air Force. So Friday, 14th of June, 2024, Ukrainian troops launched precision strikes on Su-34 bombers used by Russia to drop glide bombs, a source told Sky News. And they're trying to make this out as if they're doing to Russia's Su-34 fighter bomber fleet what they've done to the Russian Black Sea fleet, which was compelled them to move out of range and continue conducting operations in support of special military operation now unhindered, safe and unhindered by the potential of a successful Ukrainian drone strike. In that case, maritime drones, also the air-launched cruise missiles that were being used, attackums maybe. In this case, they're using drones to carry out these attacks on Russian warplanes. Now they're saying this is the second such attack in 2 months. Did the attack in April cause any damage? And the answer is most likely not. And what is the source? The Institute for the Study of War, one of the premier pro-Ukrainian propaganda platforms out there, cited all across the Western media. And here, if you read their take, they mention Ukrainian claims to have destroyed all of these different types of Russian warplanes. But they themselves say they have seen no such evidence. ISW has not yet observed any visual confirmation that Ukrainian forces damaged or destroyed aircraft or infrastructure at any of the air bases. And if you search their website for the name of this air base that was targeted, Morozovsk Air Base, you will see there's only two entries. This one in April, saying they have seen no evidence of these Ukrainian claims. And now the one that just took place this month, earlier this month, mentioned in the Sky News article. And here is the bottom line with these type of attacks. Yes, they carry them out. Yes, sometimes they're successful, but no, they do not take place nearly often enough or are conducted on a large enough scale to impede the operation of Russian Su-34 fighter bombers and their sorties dropping glide bombs along the line of contact at up to 3,000 per month, 100 per day, all along the line of contact. That is the bottom line. That is the takeaway. Now, since we're talking about military aviation, let's do an update on the French Mirage 2000 TAC-5 warplanes that France announced it would be sending to Ukraine. And like so many of these claims, there's a lot of promises made, but then as reality begins to set in, we see a lot of walking back of the narratives that are first put out there. So this is actually a Business Insider article. Western media, like the F-16 French Mirage 2000 TAC fighters, are good planes, but they aren't the best Western jets for Ukraine. So neither the Mirage 2000 nor the F-16 are the best Western jets for Ukraine. This is what the article is admitting. It says, the Mirage 2000 TAC-5, like its F-16 counterpart, is a good fourth generation fighter jet that will bring some additional capabilities to Ukraine's fleet of aging Soviet era warplanes. But neither aircraft is necessarily the best fit for Kiev given the current battlefield conditions. So citing Justin Bronk, an air power and technology expert at the UK-based Royal United Services Institute, RUSI think tank. That's who they're citing throughout this article. The effectiveness of the Mirage 2000 TAC-5 is primarily limited by the Mika Beyond Visual Range air-to-air missile, which has a much shorter range than the AIM-120 AMRAAM variants that Kiev could use with its F-16s, Bronk said. And the AMRAAM is already an unsatisfactory tool to address Russian air threats near the front lines because Moscow's formidable ground-based surface-to-air missile systems force Ukrainian fighters to fly at relatively low altitudes, putting limitations on the effectiveness of their missiles, Bronk said. And the counter argument to that will be, well, Ukraine is taking out all of Russia's S-300, S-400 long range air defense systems. I will get to that claim here in just a moment. Justin Bronk talks about Sweden's JAS-39 Gripen and says that this is a much better aircraft. It was designed specifically to be used in a distributed manner, utilizing roads as runways instead of keeping them all at established air bases. And apparently their armament is superior to the Mirage 2000 TAC-5, maybe even the F-16, I don't know. But it doesn't matter because Sweden doesn't make enough of these to transfer over to Ukraine. The decision to send F-16s has already been made and it's already underway. And France is committed to sending Mirage 2000 TAC-5s by sending a third aircraft that's not manufactured nearly in as many numbers as would be necessary to support Ukraine in this conflict would mean further complicating the training and logistics required, which is another point that Justin Bronk makes in this Business Insider article, that you're complicating it by adding in additional aircraft. You have pilots that have to train on two different, you have to break up your pilots into two different groups, have them train on completely different aircraft. The ground crews have to train to maintain two completely different aircraft. Your logistics network now has to accommodate two completely different aircraft with different requirements. And what about those F-16s? We have this article from Canada's Globe and Mail. Ukraine's Air Force may keep some F-16 warplanes abroad to protect them from Russian strikes. So let me read through this. Ukraine may keep some of its F-16 fighter jets it's set to receive from its Western allies at foreign bases to protect them from Russian strikes, a senior Ukrainian military officer said. Belgium, Denmark, the Netherlands, and Norway have committed to providing Ukraine with over 60 U.S.-made F-16 fighter jets to help it fend off Russian attacks. Ukrainian pilots are currently undergoing training to fly the warplanes ahead of the deliveries expected to start later this year. Sergei Holobistov, head of aviation within Ukraine's Air Force, said that a certain number of aircraft will be stored at secure air bases outside of Ukraine so that they are not targeted here. He told U.S. government-funded Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty, that these F-16s could be used to replace damaged aircraft as they undergo repairs, as well as for training Ukrainian pilots abroad. So very similar to what they've been doing with armored vehicles. When an M1 Abrams, whatever is left of Germany's Leopard 2 tanks sent to Ukraine, whenever they're damaged and they need to be repaired, they go to Poland. They do not stay inside Ukraine. There's no real serious effort to repair them and maintain them in Ukraine because they know that those facilities will be struck by Russian missiles and drones. So they're going to do something very similar with the F-16s. That's the story. That's my understanding of this announcement, that they will send the F-16s being used by the Ukrainians to Ukraine. They will be stored and operated in Ukraine. They will have these additional aircraft outside of Ukraine, and they will be sent as F-16s are destroyed, both on the ground and during sorties. So Alex Cristoforo of the Duran suggests that this may be a possible cover story for the planes just operating straight out of Romania, or the planes carrying out missions, being armed and fueled inside Ukraine, carrying out missions, and then ultimately basically hiding in, say, Romania. The other possibility is that the F-16s will just be operating outside of Ukraine entirely. They will be based in, say, Romania at the Fetesti Air Base on the southeast coast of Romania along the Black Sea. They could even be piloted by NATO personnel, and they conduct their sorties, and then they return to Romania, they imagine, out of range, out of reach of Russian retaliation, out of fear that an attack on an airbase in Romania would trigger a collective NATO retaliation. What is expected of these F-16s? What is expected of them? And that might help us determine how Ukraine might go about using them. Where would they operate them from? How feasible is any of this? This is what the article claims. The F-16s will help protect frontline and border regions from Russian glide bombs that have inflicted significant damage to both troops and residential areas, including Kharkiv. Glide bombs are heavy Soviet-era bombs fitted with precision guidance systems and launched from aircraft flying out of range of air defenses. I think we will succeed, first of all, in pushing back the aircraft that drop glide bombs farther from the contact line. If we manage to push them back at least another 30 to 50 kilometers, this can already be considered a turning point and an achievement, if not of superiority, then of parity in airspace. But the U.S. and its allies are not even talking about sending enough F-16s to create air superiority or even parity with Russia. The numbers simply aren't there. And if it is Ukrainian pilots piloting these F-16s, they have not been trained nearly extensively enough to be effective, nor are there enough Ukrainian pilots even being trained in the first place to operate enough F-16s to reach parity or superiority over Russian military aviation. Russia has hundreds and hundreds of military aircraft and pilots to operate them. We're talking about at most 60 F-16s, many of which will be in storage and just incrementally fed into Ukraine as Ukraine loses F-16s, again, on the ground or on missions, just like they lost all of their Soviet-era warplanes that they had at the beginning of the special military operation, and all the Soviet-era warplanes that were transferred over to them from Eastern European countries throughout the special military operation. Those are all gone. That is why they're sending F-16s. That is why France is talking about Mirage 2000s. If we go to the U.S. Air Force's official website, AF.mil, they talk all about the F-16 Fighting Falcon, its capabilities. This is what it says. In an air-to-surface role, the F-16 can fly more than 500 miles, 860 kilometers, deliver its weapons with superior accuracy, defend itself against enemy aircraft, and return to its starting point. An all-weather capability allows it to accurately deliver ordnance during non-visual bombing conditions. And then we have to assume that it can engage targets even further in the air-to-air role. So if we look at a map, and let's just assume that these F-16s will be operated by NATO pilots out of Fetesti Air Base in southeastern Romania, right here. And we use this tool here, and we create a radius of 860 kilometers, because that's how far it can fly out before it has to return back to base. And this is how far it can fly out, engage targets, and then return back to base. So right around here. As you can see from Fetesti Air Base, it can reach the line of contact here in eastern Ukraine, along the line of contact in the Donbas region. And of course, the F-16 doesn't need to travel all the way to the line of contact. They need to just get in range of what their air-to-air missiles are capable of striking. So if their air-to-air missiles have a range of tens or even up to 100 kilometers, they can fire their missiles if they can find and lock onto a target from much further away from behind the line of contact, avoiding the potential of being downed by Russian surface-to-air defense systems. The problem is, you're talking about intercepting Su-34 Russian warplanes dropping glide bombs. You are going to be flying out of southeastern Romania, 860 kilometers away, 800 plus kilometers away. Or you're at some air base in western Ukraine, and you still have to fly quite a distance to the line of contact. If you're placing F-16 warplanes anywhere near the line of contact, they're going to be able to be targeted and destroyed by a much wider variety of Russian military capabilities. So can you actually fly sorties to intercept incoming Su-34 glide bomb missions? That's going to be very difficult to do. If Russia makes the mistake of conducting glide bomb strikes on a regular schedule using a regular route, like the United States was doing in Serbia with its F-117 stealth fighters taking the same route at the same time every night, Serbian air defense operators were able to finally lock onto it and intercept it and down it. Stealth fighter that's supposed to be invisible to radar. If Russia were to be careless like that with its glide bomb sorties, then yes, possibly you could time F-16 sorties to go out and try to meet them and engage them. So it's going to be rather difficult. Can F-16 fighters potentially intercept and down Su-34 fighter bombers carrying out glide bomb missions? And the answer is yes. Theoretically, it could be done. It could possibly even happen. It could happen several times, just like Ukraine was able to use Patriot missile systems along the line of contact to target and down several Su-34 bombers. Certainly not as many as Ukraine claimed, but they did manage to down Su-34 fighter bombers dropping glide bombs. The problem is, you get close to the line of contact, Russia knows that you're there somewhere, they're going to invest in finding you and destroying you, which is what has happened. The Russian military began destroying Patriot missile systems in Ukraine. A lot of people suspect that these Patriot missile systems were benefiting from at least some sort of assistance from NATO personnel. So it's a very similar scenario to what we expect to see with the use of F-16s. And it's going to end up as another battle of attrition within a much wider war of attrition, where F-16s are going to be taking a big risk of being shot down, destroyed, the pilots killed, trying to down these Su-34 bombers, which Russia will always have more of than, at least if Ukraine is operating them with Ukrainian pilots, Russia will always have an advantage in terms of numbers, in terms of military aviation. If there are F-16s flown out of Romania, operated by NATO pilots, that is going to give a large, that is going to place a larger number of F-16s above the battlefield. And that could possibly complicate matters. But again, you're now traveling a very long distance to conduct these missions. You're going to pop up on the radar of various air defense systems all along the line of contact that Russia has. And you risk being targeted and destroyed before you even reach a range where you can engage these Su-34 fighter bombers. So it's not a sure bet. And that's why even the Western media, Western politicians and leaders, military leaders are all saying that we're sending these F-16s, but they're not going to change the course of the fighting. Of course, they're not going to, I would assume, even if they were operated by NATO pilots out of Romania. Speaking of Patriot missile systems, this is from the New York Times. U.S. to send another Patriot missile battery to Ukraine. The system is one of the best air defense weapons. That's up for debate. But the United States and its allies have a limited supply. Well, quantity factors into quality, especially in attritional warfare. This was June 11, 2024. We've heard about Germany possibly sending another Patriot missile system, maybe a battery. A battery can include up to 8 launchers. It also includes command unit, radar, power generation. It even should include personnel that can maintain and repair the system, and even force protection, maybe a small force with man-portable air defense systems to protect this air defense system from airborne threats that come in at close range that maybe have evaded the Patriot missile system. It's a longer range system. The New York Times says the new Patriot system, second that the United States has sent to Ukraine, will come from Poland, where it has been protecting a rotational force of American troops who will be returning to the United States, officials said. So they're taking operational US Patriot missiles. This is how desperate they've become. They're taking a battery that was actually protecting US forces, and they're just going to send it to Ukraine, and the U.S. forces that it was protecting, they're going back to the United States. If you send U.S. forces back to Poland, are they going to have to take a Patriot missile battery from the U.S. and send it with them, or are they just going to forgo air defense protection? The system could be deployed to Ukraine's front lines in the next several days, U.S. officials said, depending on any maintenance or modifications it needs. Considering one of the United States' best air defense weapons, the Patriot includes a powerful radar system and mobile launchers that fire missiles at incoming projectiles. Also, one of the scarcest weapon systems in the U.S. arsenal. If you have the best air defense system on Earth, but you don't make nearly enough of them, nor interceptors for them to fire, then is it actually effective? Because if your enemy is able to just simply overwhelm this superior air defense system just through sheer numbers, overwhelm it and then destroy it, and it no longer is on the battlefield, was that a successful weapons program overall? And the answer is no, it is a failure. It's just like Nazi Germany and all of its wonder weapons. They had incredible capabilities on paper, but they simply did not exist in quantities large enough to make any difference on the battlefield. And even in battle, they suffered many setbacks that betrayed their reputation, again, based on their performance on paper. And I want to remind people just how scarce the Patriot missile system is, and how scarce the missiles are that are made for it to fire. This is from Defense News. How Patriot proved itself in Ukraine and secured a fresh future. This was from April 9th, 2024, so relatively recent. This is what it said. In 2018, Lockheed's annual rate of building the missiles was 350. The company planned to increase that to 500 annually. But Russia's full-scale invasion of Ukraine in February 2022 has put new pressure on this effort, and the U.S. Army has provided funding to get Lockheed to 550 missiles per year. In December, the firm said it had reached a rate of 500 per year. So December last year, 2023, they claim that they're making 500 missiles a year. I give them benefit of the doubt and say 600, because even 600 missiles makes absolutely no difference given the scale of this conflict in Ukraine. Standard operating procedure for air defense systems is to launch two interceptors for every incoming target. This is to maximize the probability of an intercept. Yes, you can fire just one missile at each incoming target, but you're going to reduce the probability of it actually intercepting it. 600 missiles allows you to intercept 300 incoming targets. Let's just say 600 missiles are launched with 100% accuracy at 600 incoming targets. How many missiles is Russia launching into Ukraine every single year? The answer to that question is more than 4,000. So you could see what the problem is. You could see how, whether it's 350, 500, 550, 600, it doesn't matter. It's nowhere near what Ukraine needs to actually intercept all of these missiles. And this is why, despite Ukraine claiming each time Russia launches missiles at targets across Ukraine, they claim they've intercepted almost all of them, but their power grid has been more or less destroyed. It's because they're not actually intercepting them. They have no possible means of intercepting them, especially with the Patriot missile system. Now, I want to get back to this Business Insider article about the Mirage 2000 TAC-5, because they asked him about the Mirage 2000. I wanted to also talk about F-16s, which is linked to the Patriot missile systems being sent. But they also ask him about this plan of Paris to train a brigade of Ukrainian troops inside France and then sending them back to Ukraine. And I've already talked about this, but I just want to relay what was said in this article about it. So then it says, Macron has also revealed plans to train and equip a brigade of 4,500 Ukrainian soldiers, which will be a significant development and a notable break from some previous training schemes. One of the biggest problems that Ukraine is currently facing is a lack of training capacity, particularly the capacity to train at a larger unit level, so battalions and brigades rather than companies and smaller, Bronk said. Instead of offering lots of short courses for smaller numbers of troops, a strategy that showed its limitations during Kiev's failed counteroffensive last summer because it didn't generate officers, the French plan offers a way for Ukrainian troops to train as a unified formation with standardized equipment, Bronk said. That, he added, is an incredibly useful and incredibly well thought out way of increasing and stabilizing long-term support. That's really potentially impactful. Well, this is why he's a military aviation expert, not a land warfare expert, because none of that is even remotely close to reality. The entire reason the U.S. wasn't building up brigades for Ukraine is because it's impossible to do that in 6 months, a year, or even 2 years, especially under the conditions that Ukraine is fighting this proxy war under. I've talked about how even under ideal conditions, it could take 30 months or more to stand up a new brigade. That's when you have officers and non-commissioned officers to serve leadership roles among the various subunits that make up an entire brigade. A brigade is not just 4,500 entry-level soldiers with guns running toward the enemy. It is a highly organized military unit with subunits, and it's supposed to use its various units to conduct combined arms warfare together with other units. That takes a long time to get right. 30 months, 33 months, that's how long the U.S. thinks it would take to stand up entirely new brigades. If it was ever in a war with, say, Russia or China, and entire brigades were getting wiped out. Ukraine is in a war where entire brigades are being wiped out. They do not have officers and NCOs to bring in to fill all of these positions in a new brigade. And France cannot train them over the course of 6 months, a year, or even 2 years. That is impossible. It can take years of education and training to provide a competent officer. It can take years of experience for a senior NCO, which would be required among some of the larger formations in a brigade. It simply isn't feasible, which is why NATO hasn't been doing it and why the French plan to try to do this is more PR than pragmatism. It simply is impossible. It will not work. So what France is actually going to do is exactly what I said. They're going to take 4,500 conscripts forced into service. They're going to train them, give them basic training entirely inadequate to go into combat. They're going to give them weapons. They're going to send them back to Ukraine. And then they're going to be used in smaller unit formations because there's no possible way for them to coordinate as a brigade. It is impossible. And I'm sure that in time, this French armed and trained brigade, we will watch it be decimated on the battlefield. In previous updates, I've talked about a theory of victory. We keep hearing various Western commentators, political leaders, military leaders, analysts, all talking about what Ukraine can do to change the tide in the fighting. What can they do? And they always come back to Crimea and the Black Sea because they, in their minds, they view this as a huge success already. The removal of the Black Sea fleet from the conflict, which is a fallacy. The Black Sea fleet primarily has been used to launch caliber cruise missiles at targets all across Ukraine. Caliber cruise missile has such a long range that does not matter where the Black Sea fleet is located in the Black Sea. Those cruise missiles can reach their targets, and they still use the Black Sea fleet to fire these cruise missiles. The ultimate stated objective, of course, is isolating, suffocating, strangling, and seizing Crimea from Russia. And we have an article. Again, this isn't dated 2022 or 2023. This is dated June 11th, 2024. Alexander Mikouris and Alex Christoforo both covered this. I want to get into this a little deeper. Putin may be about to lose Crimea. And I want to show you how this headline is directly contradicted by the body of this article, where Tom Sharp, who is a former UK naval officer. He's a former Royal Navy officer. He's a graduate of the Advanced Command and Staff course run by the UK's Joint Service Command and Staff College. So you would think he would know what he was talking about, but surprisingly, or perhaps unsurprisingly, it seems like he does not. The unsinkable aircraft carrier may not be sinking, but it's quite dangerous to be abroad. So even this kind of contradicts the headline. Are they going to lose Crimea, or is it just going to be uncomfortable to be in Crimea? Which is it? This is what he says in the article. I'm not going to read the whole article, but I'm going to read certain parts of it and lay this out concisely. Last October, the UK Armed Force Minister, James Heapy, described Russia's Black Sea Fleet as functionally defeated based on the losses they were sustaining to drone and missile attacks enabled by special forces activities. But then he admits that all the Black Sea Fleet did was just move out of range of these strikes, and they continue launching cruise missiles, exactly what I just said. And then he says, Russia has long since lost any surveillance and targeting capability in the Western Black Sea, and its calibers are thus no menace to merchant ships moving between Odessa and Romanian waters. The problem is, Russia was never using caliber cruise missiles to strike at merchant vessels in the Black Sea. They're using them for land targets all across Ukraine. Infrastructure, military targets, logistics, command and control. They're not using them to sink merchant vessels. And this claim that they don't have any surveillance capabilities is just based on the Black Sea fleet's assets being moved out of range of the Western Black Sea. It does not mean that Russia doesn't have surveillance capabilities. They have satellites in space that can see anywhere on the planet Earth. So I don't know what Tom Sharp is talking about here. If Russia has surveillance and intelligence capabilities to strike anywhere else in Ukraine, even in Western Ukraine, to cripple its power grid, as admitted even by the Western media, surely they can see and identify potential targets in the Western Black Sea. Then Sharp starts talking about Ukraine using attackums to strike the Crimean bridge, claiming it's not operating at full capacity from two previous attacks, and he doesn't explain how that is, and he doesn't provide any evidence of that claim at all. So he's talking about striking and destroying the Crimean bridge, and again, this is all part of isolating Crimea itself. And then he starts talking about the land bridge, which runs from Kherson, Zaporozhye, and across southern Donbas to the rest of Russia. That is how Crimea is connected via the land bridge. He also admits that there's at least the Kerch port. He leaves out the fact that there's many other major ports along the coast of Crimea used to move goods and people back and forth. He says Russia has also increased the use of roll-on, roll-off ferries at Kerch, allowing more supplies to flow across the strait, but the ferries have now been hit by attackums and are out of use. And so this is his source right here. UK Ministry of Defense, who also claimed that Russia took Bakhmut with shovels, World War II shovels. And they talk about damaging two Russian roll-on, roll-off rail ferries. And then he talks about Russia also operates vehicle roll-on, roll-off ferries to support the movement of heavy loads across the strait, which have resumed operations post-strike. So two rail ferries were allegedly damaged. Were they put out of operation? Again, no evidence provided to suggest that. No evidence to provide they only have two roll-on, roll-off rail ferries. And then they're admitting that the rest of the port operations at Kerch port resumed after the strike. So you carried out this strike. You were unable to even put the port out of operation. You damaged two ferries. The extent of the damage never made clear. No evidence to support that it was permanent. That is what they achieved with an attackum strike, which includes several attackums required to overwhelm Russian air defenses, missile defenses, so that at least some can get through and cause damage. And we see that these strikes don't happen very often, maybe once or twice a month. And that is the extent of the damage caused. I almost guarantee you that whatever damage was caused by that attackum strike is going to be repaired before the next attackum strike. And if that's the case, you are not carrying out your attacks frequently enough or on a large enough scale to inhibit port operations. And if you cannot do that, you cannot isolate Crimea. Because again, remember, Crimea returned to Russia in 2014. The Kerch Bridge, Crimean Bridge, was completed in 2018. The land bridge was established in 2022. For several years, Russia was supplying all of Crimea's civilian and military needs via ports and airports. Then Sharp's Telegram article continues. He says, in other words, there are only two arteries keeping Crimea alive, the new railway and a reduced Kerch bridge, both of which are in Attackum's range. But the port hasn't been taken out because the reference he used, the Ministry of Defense of the UK, admit that other port operations, including the use of ferries, resumed right after the strike. So he's not even right about that. He's not even accurately depicting what the sources he's citing said. Then he starts talking about different ways he imagines Ukraine can destroy the Crimean Bridge, including combined attacks using attackums and maritime drones, also Storm Shadow and Scalp air-launched cruise missiles. This is this obsession with hitting the Kerch Bridge. And I think at some point, he even admits that destroying the Kerch Bridge, the Crimean Bridge, would be symbolic. I'll get to that in a moment. He says, it's clear that no matter what attackums they have, they can cut the overland railway whenever they like. It could be repaired quite quickly. It's hard to cripple a railway laid over flat country for a long time, but that supply route is clearly no longer to be relied upon. But if you can repair it sometimes even on the same day and get it operations resumed, plus there's a road network also supplying Crimea, then actually it can be relied on. There's this myth that somehow just because attackums are in range of a certain rail or road artery, that somehow Ukraine has fire control over it and they can disrupt logistics along it. And that is a fallacy. Even fighting between Russian and Ukrainian forces over the same city, say Bakhmut, where everyone is in range of each other with their artillery, their drones, Russia has military aviation with glide bombs, even then, and exercising fire control over logistics routes with many times more weapons than just a ballistic missile, a long-range ballistic missile, a relatively longer range ballistic missile, it's still very hard to completely cut logistics. You can complicate it, you can strangle it, you can create a dilemma for the forces in, say, the Ukrainian forces in Bakhmut, but they were never entirely able to cut it off completely. And fire control over these logistic routes were a contributing factor to Ukraine's loss of Bakhmut, but it wasn't the only factor. It was one of several. The combined effect of everything Russia was doing in terms of attrition, advancing, and strangling logistics, all of this played a role in finally evicting Ukrainian forces. You cannot do that with just ATACMS alone on an extremely long rail line, which is accompanied by a network of roads. The Ukrainians have shown both ingenuity and simultaneity in their attacks many times now. Storm Shadow, for example, into one of the barges, followed by a wave of maritime drones through the gap, would overwhelm any defenses there and might see the bridge down. This would be totomic in its own right, but even worse, a simultaneous attack on the overland rail line would mean that all supplies for the Dnipro front and various bases in Crimea had to come by truck through an overburdened road network under the hammer of Zelensky's guns and missiles. Whilst railways are easier to repair than bridges, supply problems on the peninsula would quickly mount, and Russia's ability to use it as a base would diminish even further. A double win. Except he's forgetting the ports. He's forgetting that even that ATACMS strike on Kerch port only damaged two ferries, did not destroy or sink them, and all other port operations resumed right after the strike. So unless you're able to not only knock out Kerch port and every other major port along the coast of Crimea, which they simply don't have the missiles to do, and you're able to keep them out of operation, which requires possibly weekly missile salvos, successful missile salvos at each of the ports, then you're not going to strangle Crimea in the way Mr. Tom Sharp imagines, former Royal Navy officer. And then he concludes this article by saying, there are plenty who believe Russia somehow has unlimited resources to call on as this war grinds on, but that doesn't sound like it to me. With many troops recently drawn off to the north for the failed assault on Kharkov. What failed assault on Kharkov? It was, I mean, he doesn't even explain how it failed or what the objective even was. And so you start to get a feel that this whole article is just empty platitudes, empty rhetoric, just very poorly constructed propaganda. He says, it could just be that the battered Russian forces in Crimea are ripe to be overrun. Maybe Crimea doesn't need Ukrainian boots on the ground at all. Choke the arteries, increase the squeeze, and wait for the missiles, ammo, and basic supplies to dry up. Then watch the bills mount as Putin is forced to burn resources to hold on to the peninsula, achieving nothing but avoiding a propaganda loss. Add in the embarrassment factor, and Crimea becomes not just a greatly reduced operational base, but a negotiating point with strategic utility across the whole conflict. What about this part about the missiles, ammo, and basic supplies drying up? Does Mr. Tom Sharp realize that Russia is conducting somewhat extensive military operations in Syria from a military base supplied solely through military aviation and maritime shipping? Does he realize that? And does he realize that Crimea is much closer to Russia, the rest of Russia, than its military base in Syria is? And how, at a minimum, if nothing else, Russia would be able to resupply its military forces on the Crimean Peninsula? He has said nothing in this article, and no theory of victory has ever been presented to explain how they would be somehow able to prevent Russia from, at a minimum, resupplying its military forces in Crimea. You're unable to even disrupt temporarily port operations at the Kerch port, despite using your ATACMS missiles, of which you have a limited supply. You still have not blown up the Kerch bridge, Crimean bridge. Even if you do, you still have the ports and the land bridge to contend with. And the land bridge is sitting there. If it's so easy to disrupt and create logistical havoc, why haven't they done it already. And the reason they haven't is the same reason Russia doesn't spend all of its missiles and drones blowing up rail sections of rail across Ukraine, because it can be repaired in the same day and you're just wasting missiles and drones. And Ukraine has far fewer missiles and drones to waste than Russia does. Let's talk about a more feasible objective. Using attackums to possibly degrade Russian air defenses on the Crimean Peninsula. So let's go to this Forbes article here. This is dated June 12, 2024. Ukrainian attackums rockets are blowing up Russia's best S-400 air defenses as fast as S-400s can deploy to Crimea. A Tuesday rocket raid may have knocked out three Russian radars, okay? Three Russian radars, let's keep this in mind. Three Russian radars, that is what they claim they have destroyed after this attackums strike. In mid-May, the Ukrainian army launched a powerful barrage of 10 American-made army tactical missile systems, rockets at a Russian base in Belbek outside Sevastopol in occupied Crimea. Photos from the ground confirmed the two-ton attackums, each scattering hundreds of grenade-sized bomblets, destroyed a radar and two launchers from an S-400 air defense battery. There were reports the rockets also damaged four warplanes at a nearby military airfield. So out of 10 attackums, 10 missiles launched, two got through. You have to remember, these cluster munitions spread over an entire area. So if you have warplanes parked next to each other, it only takes one attackums to get through. Those cluster munitions deploy and you can destroy several aircraft with a single missile. That's the whole point of these cluster munitions. And if you deploy over an air defense system, if they're all if the whole system is bunched together, the launchers, the radar, the command center, when those cluster munitions deploy, again, they're going to damage or destroy all of that equipment altogether. That's why you need to disperse. So that was mid-May. Now we're in mid-June. So about one successful major attack per month. That's what we're talking about. And he's trying to make it out as if entire S-400 batteries are being wiped out, and but he's admitting that just some components of an entire battery are damaged or destroyed. And then Russia is sending replacements for these destroyed pieces of equipment. They don't have to send an entire new battery because the whole battery wasn't destroyed. So regarding this most recent attack, this is what Forbes says. Unspecified munitions, likely the same 190-mile range or around 300-kilometer range. Attackums hit Belbek in May. They rained down on Belbek S-400 as well as two other nearby air defense batteries, another S-400, as well as a shorter-range S-300. At least 10 Attackums missiles were used in the strikes to Ukrainian Center for Defense Strategies reported, with the Russian air defense system failing to intercept any of them. So 10 missiles. What did these 10 missiles who were not intercepted by Russia, that's what Ukraine claims, what did these 10 missiles strike? That's a lot of missiles getting through. Two radars were destroyed, the Ukrainian Defense Ministry claimed, one each from an S-300 and S-400 battery. Regarding the third radar, information is being clarified. So maybe two, possibly three radars. And Ukraine is claiming that Russia didn't intercept any of these 10 missiles. Does that add up? Does it add up? And the answer is obviously no. So what happened was two, possibly three of these missiles got through out of 10, and they managed to damage two, possibly three radar sets. Then Forbes, in this same article, says the Russian Air Force has more than 50 S-400 batteries, so it's not about to run out. But the batteries are useless to Russia's war effort in Ukraine if they can't survive Ukrainian rocket attacks. Well, if all you did was take out two or three radars with 10 missiles, then it appears that they are surviving Ukrainian rocket attacks, doesn't it? This isn't the first time the Western media tries to depict these infrequent, fairly unsuccessful attacks as if they are changing the battlefield somehow, pivoting the war in Ukraine's favor. Forbes itself claims Belbek is becoming an attrition trap for the Russian Air Force's best air defense system. But in order to claim that, you have to know how many S-400 and also S-300 systems Russia has, and also how many they're manufacturing each year. And I've gone over this already. In a previous update, I cited a Newsweek article titled, "How many S-400 missile systems does Russia have?" This was from May of this year, 2024. Russia likely has around 16 to 18 battalions, or 56 full S-400 systems deployed by the early 2020s. However, Russia has suffered notable losses of the prize systems in the ongoing conflict with Ukraine. This makes it difficult to establish how many are currently operational. Then it says, Pravda State newspaper, and they're talking about Ukraine Pravda, not Russian Pravda, says a regular S-400 battalion consists of 8 launchers with 32 missiles and costs around $200 million. So when you break that all down, Newsweek is saying Russia has between 16 to 18 battalions, and if each battalion has 8 launchers, that means Russia has between 128 to 144 launchers. I guess this is a lot of launchers. And then that same Newsweek article links to a list of alleged Ukrainian strikes on S-400 systems, and it says this would suggest at least a dozen have been lost in the conflict, according to Ukraine's claim, but the numbers cannot be independently verified. So when they say 12, they mean 12 components of S-400 systems, which is not a lot. That is not a lot out of a large collection of equipment, which includes 128 to 144 launchers. And then we have to ask ourselves, if that's the tiny dent that Ukraine has made over the course of 2 years, that's not like just this month or last month. Newsweek is talking about since February 2022. What about how many S-400 systems, how many launchers and associated equipment is Russia manufacturing each year? And we don't have a number on that, but we could look at a contract China signed with Russia, how long it took to fulfill that contract, the number of S-400 systems that were supplied. So China signed a contract in 2014 with Russia. It was fulfilled between 2018 and 2020. So just based on those numbers, the numbers of S-400 systems that China ordered, that means it was making between 8 to 16 launchers and associated equipment, including command centers and radars, each year. And obviously, even at that time, Russia was making more than that. That was just what they were making to fulfill their contract with China. They still have to make systems for themselves and for other customers, including nations like India, Iran, even. And so they're making many more systems than that, and that was before they ramped up military industrial production for the special military operation. But even going off of these, the lowest low-end numbers that we could confirm, Ukraine has failed to take out a single year of production over the course of 2 years of attempting to carry out strikes all across Crimea and the rest of the line of contact. And then again, don't forget that Russia has many more S-300s. It's an older system. It's been updated, modernized. There's many different versions of the S-300, and there are many more of those than S-400 systems out there. Both of them are long-range air defense systems. They're all networked into Russia's integrated air defense system. And so when you really add up the numbers, again, adding up the numbers versus the headlines and the implications that they're trying to make, you can see just how futile Ukraine's efforts are striking Crimea, trying to eliminate Russian air defenses, which almost certainly exist in larger numbers than the U.S. will send ATACMS to Ukraine. If you look at articles like this from Breaking Defense on ATACMS for Ukraine, don't settle for a job half done. The number in annual production that they cite is around 500. 500, they claim that the U.S. Army reportedly had nearly 1,500 ATACMS missiles as of late August, including over 360, and they're talking about the ones with cluster munitions that Ukraine is using to take out, right here, anti-personnel, anti-materiel, APAM bomblets. Those are the ones that they're using to try to target Russian air defense systems. So 360 is not a lot. And if Russia has between 128 to 144, just S-400 launchers alone, not talking about S-300 launchers, and you're firing 10 missiles to take out 3 radars, that it doesn't add up for Ukraine. And if you're using a missile with a unitary warhead, you fire at an air defense battery, you're going to hit one piece of equipment and everything else is going to survive if it's spaced out far enough. So this is the dilemma that Ukraine has. This isn't the first example of this. The collective West simply doesn't make enough of anything for Ukraine to use against Russia and its massive military industrial production. Ukraine itself does not have the ability to absorb some of the quantities of weapons, ammunition, and equipment that the collective West makes. Can't even use it to its fullest potential. The ATACMS are no exception. So as you can see, these ATACMS strikes, they make great headlines, but as far as winning a war of attrition, they're falling far short. The fact that they carry out these strikes once a month, they're launching 10 missiles, they're taking out two, maybe three radars, maybe a couple of launchers here and there once a month. Russia has well over 100 launchers. They're producing these systems every single year. We don't know how many ATACMS are being transferred to Ukraine, but it doesn't appear anywhere near enough to actually wipe out Russian air defenses faster than they can be replaced, quite clearly. And this is what the Forbes article continues on saying. This is the fantasy world that they continue constructing based on this one strike that destroyed two, maybe three radars, according to Ukraine. Some Russian observers are worried that much worse attacks are coming. And they always cite these pro-Russian observers who panic, get emotional, and of course, they only cite them when they say negative things about whatever Russia is doing or become overly concerned about things that Ukraine is supposedly doing. They'll never cite them when they're pointing out things that make Ukraine look bad, and they won't even tell you which Russian observers they're referring to so that you can check their work and see how reasonable it is for yourself. But then it says, if the Ukrainians are following American strike doctrine, attacks on air defense batteries come first. After that, aviation based on F-16 comes into play, under the wings of which there are a wider range of ammunition. That's what one Russian blogger noted. The Ukrainian Air Force is getting 85 ex-European Lockheed Martin F-16s and already has radar homing missiles and precision guide glide bombs for the F-16s to employ in combat. By the way, the radar homing missiles and these glide bombs, HARM and JDAM, have been rendered ineffective by Russian electronic warfare, admitted by the Western media itself. The first F-16s, former Danish examples, should arrive in Ukraine any week now. Don't be shocked if the nimble jets quickly launch for strikes on Russian bases in Crimea. Bases whose air defenses have been steadily ground down by back-to-back barrages of ATACMS rockets. Remember, the article is citing only two attacks, both of which damaged or destroyed a couple of components of entire batteries, which remained intact, and of which Russia is able to replace the damaged or destroyed equipment with new equipment. So you're not clearing out the air defenses across Crimea. You're damaging parts of specific batteries, of which there are several batteries. When you fly the F-16s into Crimea to strike ground targets, you will be destroyed. And we know this because even with the little air defense left that Ukraine has, both its Soviet-era air defense systems and those transferred to it by the West, Russia is still unable to operate its military aviation freely over the entirety of Ukraine, specifically because it only takes a couple of systems to create havoc with your military aviation. The idea that ATACMS are going to clear a path for F-16 strikes is ludicrous. It is just complete fantasy, completely detached from reality and everything that has happened in this conflict up until now. And don't forget that Russia doesn't just have these S-400 systems, which Forbes was obsessing over. It mentioned S-300s, but didn't get into how many of those Russia has and may have deployed across Crimea. And then there are medium-range air defense systems like Buk, Osa, Tor, Pantsir, and Strela that Russia can use to down these F-16s, which are much harder to detect because they're highly mobile, smaller, easier to hide, and they still have missiles that can reach the altitudes that the F-16s will be flying at if they're flying at altitude, and they're also able to obviously engage F-16s that are trying to fly close to the ground, which is why Ukraine needs F-16s in the first place, because this is how Russia destroyed all their Soviet-era warplanes. That's what these articles are meant to do. They're not informing you. They do not reflect reality. They're creating fantastical narratives that are meant to bolster hope among those across the general public still in support of Ukraine, and maybe to overwhelm and create fear among these so-called Russian observers who panic at any sign of some sort of Ukrainian success, however small it is, and how, no matter how insignificant it is when put into proper context. And of course, by bolstering hope among the public still supporting Ukraine, you can perpetuate this conflict further. And by finding weak links among those supporting Russian military efforts, creating panic and fear among them, they hope to fan the flames of wider panic and fear across the rest of the population supporting the Russian special military operation. So it's very important to continue breaking these articles down, no matter how tedious it gets sometimes, to break it down, cut through the avalanche of lies and propaganda, show people what is really happening, what it actually means when 10 missiles are launched and they only hit 3 radars, when Russia is able to make many radars every single year, along with entire S-400 batteries every year, along with S-300 and all the other many very effective air defense systems they have. There's no way that this small cadence of attack-em strikes once a month, twice a month, is ever going to cut through Russian air defenses, not in Crimea, not anywhere else, and surely not enough to cut a path for F-16s flown by Ukrainian pilots who need about a decade to effectively learn how to operate the F-16 and are only going to get a couple of months instead, just like the main battle tanks. So that's where we are with the Ukrainian conflict at the moment. I will continue keeping an eye on all of this as it continues to develop. If you thought this video in particular was useful, please like and share. Think about subscribing. It's free to do. It helps my channel grow. Check out the video description below for other places you can find and follow my work. I highly suggest people follow me on Telegram. I post absolutely everything there, including entire backups of all of my videos. If you don't want to watch my videos on YouTube, Telegram is the place to go, and there's so many other great resources on Telegram. I will include the links to Alexander Mercuris and Alex Christoforos the Duran on Telegram, as well as Scott from Calibrated and also Mark Sloboda. These are the 3 go-to sources I follow myself to keep ahead of everything that is taking place in Ukraine. In the video description below are also all of the links that I referenced in this video, as well as for ways you can help support my work. I do not monetize any of my social media platforms, not YouTube or any other social media platform that I'm on. If ads pop up, feel free to skip them. They're not helping me out at all. If you do want to help support my work, please do so through Buy Me a Coffee and also through Patreon. And to everyone who has been helping out, whether it's a one-time donation, donations month to month, or even if you have no additional resources and all you're doing is sharing my work with others, getting the word out there, that is all greatly appreciated. That is what makes this work possible. So thank you. And as always, thank you for watching.